All right, guys. Well, I want to say Happy New Year to everyone and welcome back to Breakfast of Champions and Covenant Keepers. I pray everybody had a, gosh, a wonderful time away. I know I did. Y'all, I have binged and slept and slept and enjoyed. I have read, I don't know, about three, four books on audio and just really had a great time. So I hope you guys have found some great niches for yourself as well. Found some great TV shows to binge up on during our time away, and then also finding time to get into the presence of God for the plans for the new year. I hope you guys did well. Before we get started, let me stop and check on everybody. How was everybody's New Year coming in? Do y'all have a How was your time away? Have you guys enjoyed your time away? Anybody want to share? We're going to start talking this year. I don't want to be the only one talking. Did y'all enjoy your time away? Was it hard for y'all to get up this morning too? Or is it just me?
Good morning. Yes, ma'am. I enjoyed my time. A little rest and getting stuff done around the house and prepared for the new year and everything. But yes, and New Year's was good, spending with bringing it in with the grandbaby kids and my mother. So
Oh, I love that. I love it. Anybody else want to kind of share this morning? Shirley says she enjoyed her time away. Shirley, you still got your coughing? Is your coughing getting better? Are you getting better with that? Anybody else? I know y'all been off with the kids. Y'all have been enjoying the kids at home. Anybody? She still got it. Yes. Amen.
Y'all don't like to
Grandbaby.
share. Y'all gotta talk. Y'all gotta talk.
I know. Help them talk, Marcus, this
Know,
morning.
y'all get up and talk. Just say something, you know. Y'all text, say something.
That's
Oh good.
right.
We had I guess we had a good time. I don't take off from work. I guess I'm kind of self-employed, you know, so I work for myself. So but kids been home and they go back to school today. So that's a good thing, you know. Getting ready to take them in a few minutes.
Amen, Marcus. Well, you said that's a good thing.
Yeah, it's a good thing. They bored too, cause they all want to go somewhere and spend money that I don't really want to spend at the time. You know, I'm like, okay,
Yeah.
spend.
Yeah, I've been picking up a lot of Uber kids and bowling alleys. They've been going somewhere everywhere. I miss.
Right?
Huh?
Yeah, right. That's what they want to do. They just want to hang out.
I think those parents are glad for Uber. Uber, pick them up and drop them off
Drop them off.
now. Yes. Miss Gina, I saw your mic open. Were you on the chair this morning?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, I enjoyed my time, my rest. Yeah, that's set my clock and still overslept this morning. Yeah, my grandbaby been driving me crazy. She don't go back to school till tomorrow. She goes to Cumberland. So she's like, well, Gigi, you're off tomorrow. Can I go get my nails done? And she want to bargain with me. You know, if I wash the dishes, can I do that? I was, you go wash the dishes anyway. You like you got
Anyway.
chores around, right? Chores around here, so. Yeah, I've been enjoying my little time off too.
Good. Yeah. Anybody else want to share this morning? How y'all been enjoying your time away?
Good
Much needed.
morning.
Good morning, Felicia.
Happy New Year, everyone.
Happy New Year.
I must say, as long as I've been in my job, going on 16 years this month, I had never taken off a whole week.
Oh, did you get a
I've been
whole
off.
week
I took
off?
off December the 22nd and I went back yesterday. The lady that relieved me came up there. She hugged me three times. She said, I just value your job. She said, I'll tell everybody, I can do your job. I'm so glad you're back.
I
Boy, that took a
love
me. But anyway, I enjoyed my time off. I didn't get any rest. I ripped and ran every day. I took care of some business. And on Saturday, I got sick. I said, Lord, what a way to bring in the new year, but God is good. He still sits on the throne. But anyway, I have two doctor's appointments today, and I want y'all to pray for me. So anyway, I just wanted to share that, and I hope everyone did have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Amen. Thank you, Felicia. Thank you. Anybody else want to share this morning? How was your time away? Just make sure we check in with everybody. Okay. All right, y'all be sure. Listen, we're going to start the new year off right. If you want something different to take place, you got to start doing something different yourself. So, let's make sure that we get active and, and involved with things. So, but anyway, we definitely want to get this week started off. We're starting kind of midweek with everything, but we are still in our book, God Will Make a Way. And how many of you can say that you are still in the mix of something that you need God to bring you through with? And sometimes you just can't get the answers to it, just can't figure it out, and you're just wondering, God, when? Any of y'all still got some stuff? I know we all do, but anybody want to admit that you got some stuff still in the clutches that all right, God, if it's gonna happen, it's gonna have to happen through you. Anybody? I know we all do. All right. All right. Well, y'all, let's do something different this year. Felicia said me, let's do something different this year. Let's start getting actively involved in the conversation. If we're gonna be up, we might as well go on and be up and, kind of share the conversation with everyone. And it helps with the conversation moving forward. And then it helps me not to have to, have all the conversation as we're going forward. I will stop to, I love to hear from y'all, but if we have a lot of, dead air or whatever, I'll always try to fill it in. Y'all feel free to raise your hand up if, anything that we're discussing that you want to, kind of jump in with, because believe it or not, the majority of your deliverance from whatever it is that you're going through is going to happen when you speak up. You may think that, well, I'm just gonna, quietness and confidence is gonna be my strength, but I'm just gonna get over here and sit down somewhere, be still. God will make a way some kind of way. But the Bible says faith without works is dead, being alone. You can't just have faith to know that God is gonna do something and not get actively involved in it. You can't just purchase a car and don't put no gas in it when you know you got somewhere to go. You can't just bring children into the world and don't find a plan or something for them to do. You can't even bring kids home for a winter break and just let them sit around the house. It will drive you cuckoo and drive you crazy. You got to find something to get actively involved in, and that's how it is with the spoken word. Also, anything that I have seen God do in my life, God gave me a seed to work with, but he also gave me a spoken promise, and I have to repeat that promise back to God. Your word said, that's why we're always searching for the word of God. You know how it is when, things get, get heavy up on you, or, when you just need some encouragement or whatever, you'll try to find something that will kind of soothe your soul through some things. You're looking for a spoken word. You're looking for an answer to whatever the situation is. And when you hear it, you got to identify and say, yes, God, that's it right there. That's what it is. And then get actively involved in it, because otherwise things may not happen in your life. Some of the things that we're waiting on is not, we're not waiting on God all the time. God said, I've given you a seed. He said, I give seed to the sower and I give bread to the eater. I want you to go in there and plant that seed that I've given to you, and then water that seed, and then watch God bring it to pass the way that he wants to bring it to pass. But you definitely have to get in there and sow some things out there. Amen. Well, we are continuing on. We are on chapter, I think this is 5, where we're talking about owning your faults and your weaknesses. And this is going to be a great story this time. It's going in, it's talking about a little bit of a painful situation at the beginning of it. There's a couple that Henry is every story that you guys are hearing in the book is from a counseling session that he has actually had. And what he's doing is he's bringing it in and coupling it with the word of God, or coupling in, remember we said, make sure that you add a knowledge to whatever it is that you do. There's a what was it called? It said that I'm trying to think of that title, place high value on wisdom. Wisdom would come in to say there's nothing new up under the sun. And I love the way that Henry and Henry and John Townsend came together to bring their experiences and their knowledge together, because these are real life things that we all go through too, but sometimes you need to hear it in a practical form so that you too can find a place of reference. And I'm hoping this morning, once again, as we're going through the study, that you'll find a reference within your own life of some things that have gone on with you, or maybe some things that you've had to be counseled through. You know, the more I talk to people every day, folks are going to counseling now. You know, they kind of tired of going in and out of stuff over and over again. They have decided to get some help to couple in with them. And I thank God for all of the leaders that are even in our room to come in, that come to counsel and to bring, you know, a high value of wisdom in this room too. But we want to hear from you guys too. Y'all may have some wisdom on some things that, you know, you have gone through and how God helped you to work it out that may be of value to us, that will cause us not to have to struggle through some things. It can kind of give us a crack in the door, you know, to kind of get some answers. So we put a high value on the things that we, you know, the people that we have in this room and the things that we have learned through experience as well. But let's go ahead and open up with a word of prayer, and then we're going to go directly into the story this morning that Henry and John are giving us, and we're going to see if we can find our story in the midst of it all as well. Amen. All right. Well, Father, we just thank you this day. Thank you for bringing us back together again. Thank you for this awesome new year that you've set out for us. Father, it's almost like the slate has been wiped clean. It's a brand new start for us all. You know, we just come declaring that this is the day that the Lord has made, and we're rejoicing because we're getting another opportunity to join in with you. Father, we ask, Lord God, that you would, you know, sit in the midst of your people this morning as we worship you, as we acknowledge you, as we add you to the equation of everything that it is that we are going through. And Father, we ask that you would bring your wisdom in and your anointing with it all. I pray this morning that as we are waking, that even if we're waking to maybe some turbulent sounds, or maybe we're waking to some, you know, continued things that keep going on and on, or maybe we're waking up to some good news this morning, or maybe we're trying to find a way through things, Lord God, that you would, you know, come in and let us know that your presence is always there with us. You said no matter where we make our bed, Father, you will be there. Father, we lift up a special prayer for Mrs. Cookie Williams on this morning, who's challenging, has some challenges with her daughter. They're having to take her back to the hospital right now. I pray, Lord God, that your angels will go before them. Father, I pray that you would meet them in the place, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that that blood be put up over that doorpost, over their homes. I pray that you will put it over the doorpost of their mind, Lord God. I pray that you will let this mind be in them that's also in Christ Jesus. No matter what it is that they're going through, no matter what it is that's ahead of them, Father, meet them in the midst of it all. I pray, Lord God, that you will continue to strengthen Mrs. Cookie, Lord God. Give her the wisdom that she needs. Give us the courage that she needs. Help her faith to fail her not. Glory to God. Help her faith to fail her not. And Father, help her to know that this too shall pass. So Father, we stand in as intercessors this morning, standing in the gap, praying for her and with her, Lord God, because you said you wouldn't put any more on us than what we can bear. Father, we're praying for any of the others that may be going through some challenging times this morning. Help us to know trouble don't last always. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy does come in the morning. We continue to lift up our sister, Mrs. Delcina Mangrum, as well, Lord God, as you will continue to navigate her through this time of grief and loss. And I pray, Lord God, that you will continue to be a strength and a shield all around her. We lift up our sister, Mrs. Ashley, this morning, as she's still going through some medical challenges. We pray, Lord God, that you would be the wind beneath her wing as well. I pray, Lord God, that you would continue to give her the rest that she needs. I pray for the doctors, Lord God, that are working on her. I pray, Lord God, that they will find a means to this end that may be going on with her. So, Father, we bless you. Lord, bless us even in these good times that we are in. Help us to not take any of those things for granted. Father, there's a saying, we either in a storm, on our way in a storm, or we're heading out of one. No matter what it is, help us to learn the lessons that are there. So, Father, as we go in this morning for this message, owning our own faults and our weaknesses, it's just a place where we find a place of humility within us, and help us to know, Lord God, that all things are working together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to your purpose. So, Father, bless us as we come together this morning. Let it be a great week of new beginnings. Let it be a great week of fresh starts, helping us to know that we're leaning and depending on you for everything that we need. And we bless you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All righty. All right. Well, we're going to go in. I'm going to read a little bit. I'm going to start sharing the reading with you guys, for those of you that have the book. Matter of fact, let me see how many people actually have the book. And don't be saying you don't have a book because you don't want to read. Let me know who has the book so I can start calling up on y'all in the morning time, and y'all can help us to read some of the story. Anybody? Anybody got
the book? Yeah, I got the book.
All right, Marcus, I'm going to be calling up on you. Anybody else got the book this morning? I mean, we're going to get up out the bed, y'all, and get actively involved. Nobody else has the book? All right, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to start taking screenshots of the book and send it to you so y'all can help me read in the morning time. Nene says she does. All right. Anybody else besides Nene got the book? Now, I know good and well y'all should have it by now. Kathy said I do. Okay. All right. I'm taking note of these names. Tina said I do. All right. Y'all be ready some mornings, because I'm going to be calling on y'all to read some of the story, because that may be just your morning that you need a breakthrough to come through. All right, so let's talk this morning. We're on chapter 5, on your faults and weaknesses. It says, Sharon, I'm leaving. Ooh, how many of you heard that? I'll call you with my new number. We'll need to discuss the kids and finances. I'm sorry things aren't working out. Raw. Ooh, who wants to hear that story? It already got me numb thinking about what's going on with this. It said, numbly, Sharon looked around the kitchen. Pictures of herself, her husband Rob, and the kids, they were filling the walls. She felt surreal and disoriented. And if something foundational had suddenly crumbled, as if something foundationally had suddenly crumbled from under her feet. It says waves of hurt, fear, and sadness overwhelmed her. To gain some kind of equilibrium, she tried to take stock of things. She believed in God, but couldn't fathom where he was right now at this moment. She loved Rob with all of her heart. He was her soulmate and life partner. Said all those years ago when they met, both of them felt God had brought them together. She was sure of it. All the signs had been there, and he was a great father to the kids. How could it all come down to this? Sharon was aware that she and Rob had not been doing well, and this was that he was miserable in the marriage. In the last few years, he had become shut down, distant, preoccupied, even cold. She didn't feel that she could reach him. They would sit beside each other in church, not holding hands like they used to, feeling a million miles apart. To make things more difficult, Rob had been spending more and more time at the office. She was also aware of the stress they'd been through recently. Rob's company had presented him with an option to relocate to another part of the country, which would give him a much better position with the firm. If he didn't take it, he risked being laid off. When the issue had arisen, the couple and their close friends had made the decision a matter of a great deal of prayer, thought, and discussion. As it finally was clear to them that moving was the best decision. It says leaving their home, church, and close relatives had been very difficult. He said now in this new place, Rob had been trying to adjust to his work. they spent a week moving in, enrolling the kids in school, getting to know the area, meeting the neighbors, and finding a church home in which they felt they belong. In fact, the church was where my wife and I, John, met them, and why I know their story. This is when Rob would start to distance himself and shut down from her, Sharon would notice it and be concerned. I want to kind of stop right there, going back. You know, while reading, I know we're going to talk about owning our faults and our weaknesses with this, but, you know, just how many of you just listening to that can sense the stress that can, that could have been added to the family, you know, from making such a major decision, like even though it looked like they did go into counsel, with other people. It was the getting in the press that may still cause friction, may cause stress. And sometimes maybe the weight of the pressure of not always knowing what to do. And then sometimes all of a sudden, you know, those old behavior, remember we talked about last week, leaving that baggage behind, sometimes that old behavior of not reaching out to people, not knowing who to reach out to, and sometimes not even knowing the right questions to ask, can bring about some stress on you. How many of you can kind of identify at some point in your life where you have kind of felt that thump? Remember I told you that's that thump in the belly? Something drastic changed in your life and you're doing everything you can to kind of keep those pieces together and not knowing exactly what to do. How many of you kind of recognize yourself in this story before we go further or have heard this before somewhere? Anybody? I want to hear us this morning.
Yeah, I can relate to it as well, sure. You know, but just because you move away, it don't mean that things will be new or change. You got to work on what you want to be changing, that's for sure. And you, wherever you go, you take you with you.
Yeah. I love that. Anybody else? Been through this major, it may not even be with a marriage. It may be just, maybe it was a job change. It was, you know, something that you and your children had to go through, because I know we got a lot of single people on here. Maybe some things that you and your children had to go through. Y'all had to make a major move and it was stressful to you. Anybody? Yeah. When she said that, I think the part that got me when, I think for me, you know, when I can tell that I hurt for other people when they go through things. And, you know, sometimes when you sit in the position of whether it be a life coach, a counselor, or a therapist, these are conversations that we hear on a regular. And it's what the Bible talks about, that you have to have a feeling of the infirmity to what they're going through so that you can, you know, kind of be in touch with whatever the situation that's there, and you can't help but to feel for them. You know, it looked like Rob may have just left her a note, you know, and didn't take out the time to have a honest dialogue and conversation. And he says, I'm leaving. So I'll call you with my new number. We'll need to discuss the kids and finances. I'm sorry, things aren't working out. Kind of blunt. You know, it's kind of a hard blow to kind of take. You know, it says numbly Sharon looked around the kitchen. This seems to, I don't know if this is true or not, but just from maybe from my angle or whatever, and y'all can correct me, this seems to happen to women more often than men. And it kind of leaves the woman in a position to where she's already an emotional creature to begin with. But this kind of takes them on an emotional frizzy. And if there are men, I'm quite sure that men probably do the same thing. I want to kind of talk about how do you readjust when you hear conversations like that? What are the first things that you guys find yourself, you know, maybe doing? Marcus, maybe what were some of the first things, you know, when you see change taking place? What's probably some of the first things that you start thinking about? Is it survival? Is it taking care of yourself? Is it the kids, thinking about the children? What's the first thing that comes to your mind when you hear things like that or when you get in situations like that? Anybody that may want to share this morning? Just trying to get everybody to kind of jump and get involved.
I don't know. I know in the past for me, being a male, I shut down. I just close off. If I don't have, I guess I share my kids with my ex-wife more so even now than then. I guess I did that at that time as well. But since I didn't think that I had them all the time, men can think they always can just start over. And we shut down emotionally. Mm-hmm. We have emotions. Our emotions just not outward, they're inward. You know, when we talk about ladies, their emotions more outward than inward. So we internalize, and women, they'll externalize. You know, so that's the emotional difference in how we express what's going on with us. And that change process is difficult because men know how to put on these different chameleon faces. Now, women may as well, but for me, I knew how to act as if nothing was wrong with it. It was crying on the inside, breaking, you know, confused, disoriented. And I didn't want people to know that because you don't want people to know what you're going through, but
that's right.
People can't help you pull through unless they know where you're at. And I'm understanding it even more so every day as I just live life. As I get older, your knees give out, your heart give out, your feet, mm-hmm. whatever it is that getting older with you, and you have to make these adjustments. If people don't know where you're at, you go through your sickness, your aging, your ailments alone because we don't say that we need help or we need comfort and things like that. And I think those things are important for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's learning a language also, you know, of crying out. Like in the room this morning, we would never know what y'all are going through if you never say anything. That's one of the reasons we always ask you to talk up, you know, to share in the morning times, because, and I know sometimes it may sound like a air of weakness or I don't want anybody in my business, different things like that. But what happens when your business becomes public, you know, or it becomes, you know, out loud? I think it's better to find some people that you can, you know, express, you know, some of the hardest thing. I think when I'm listening to this, I think it goes later on in the story. It talks about they noticed some things. Sharon had noticed some stuff that was going on. She said Sharon was aware that she and Rob had not been doing well. Everything, nothing just happens. There are always signs. There are always cues. There are always signals that will go out. The Bible says that warning comes before destruction. And there has to be a play, even though you may not be able to do anything about it right now. But I think the very moment that you pick up on, maybe there's some different behavior that's going on, you can find someone that you can confide in. You definitely need some people to confide in when you're married, when you are making major decisions about things in life, you know, because that's where those little foxes, it says, catch you the little foxes. You know, because those are the things that destroy the vine. When we don't open up and when we don't share, we find ourselves going down a rabbit trail. It says Sharon was aware that she and Rob had not been doing well and that he was miserable, in the marriage. It says in the last few months, he had become shut down, like Marcus said. That's one of the things that men do. They may hurt just like we do. But they may go inward with things. And I think it's because they're trying to figure out things, trying to process things or trying to work things out. Said that he had become distant, preoccupied, even cold. He says she didn't feel that she could reach him. They would sit beside each other in church. You can be going to church and going through problems. You would think that, well, they were leaders in the church and, you know, they were in such big positions or whatever, but you can be going through hurt and pain and working in leadership and in various positions or whatever. She said they would sit beside each other, not holding hands like they used to. And just feeling a million miles apart. I think sometimes in relationships, we take our relationships for granted. And we think that everything is always going to be as it is. You know, I personally think that relationships need to do checkups at least every 3 months, you know, how we're doing, you know, getting involved even in couples retreats or getaways or finding times to where you guys have pillow talk. If you don't do pillow talk every night, you know, do it weekly or do it monthly or whatever. And the main thing is to make sure that you stay connected and that you can talk about the issues. Another thing, those of you that have heard me talk about the couples devotional book that I have, the devotional book is a 56-week study. Because sometimes it's hard for people to start conversations, but the 50-week study is to open up communication about different things that may be going on, you know, in your particular life. Maybe there's a hard conversation piece to have, or maybe there's a fear within the heart. Maybe there are some changes because it looked like he was going through the stress of, you know, the provision on the job. They said that if he didn't take the job, that it would kind of jeopardize, you know, certain, you know, movements, you know what I'm saying, within the relationship, different things like that. And sometimes, like Harlan said, you have to learn how to pray. Sometimes you have to be introduced to prayer because that's not always the go-to for everyone. Sometimes you have to be introduced to different things to let you know that this is going to be an important factor to add to your marriage. Marriage reminds me of somebody that is a great cook. You know, you just, my granddaughter, they were coming, they came over this weekend, and Jordan's already talking about she's gonna be doing all the cooking in the house, and y'all, she has become one of the best little cooks, but she does from scratch. She don't follow other people's recipes, she doesn't do any of that. And I said, that must be a gift that she has within. There's a certain palate that's on the taste buds, and she doesn't like things to stay the same. She likes to stay fresh. To me, this is what marriage is like, what relationships are like. You have to add to it. Sometimes you want to kind of, you know, spice it up a little bit. Maybe you need to add a little something to it. Maybe it's called humility. Sometimes it's prayer. Maybe you don't know the importance of prayer in your relationships. It could even be, you know, giving the other person time. You know, sometimes we're not patient with people. You know, give them time to talk. And the devotionals help you to kind of go through different things like that. Remember when he says to put a high value on wisdom? Anytime you start seeing things kind of getting out of hand like it is, don't take things into your own hands, and definitely don't go over and take over somebody else's responsibility for something that may be going on with them, because it may not be all that it's, you know, looking like. Things could be a little different. It says to make things more difficult. Rob had been spending more and more time at work. I'm catching the cues, you know, in the story of things that may be going wrong and I may be wrong. Maybe Harlan and Marcus kind of help me on this. Anytime in your relationships, and even with us as women too, when there's money problems, there's going to be a shift in the relationship somewhere. Yes, it says he's spending more time at work. Why is he spending more time at work? Is he struggling through something? And I'm saying that to say we have to be keen with your partners. You have to be keen, even within yourself, paying attention to little things that may change within your walk, because it's them little bitty things that's gonna add up to major issues. Yeah, he says, if the money is funny, the honey will be funny. Amen. Harlan, you wanna talk about that a little bit? You know, maybe some of the stress, maybe I know ladies that are here that's married. We're trying to walk into 2024 with a little bit more wisdom, y'all. We're not trying to go into, you know, such and such, you know, separated, went through a divorce, they going through a whole lot of stuff, all that. No, we want to find some things ahead of time that will help us kind of walk through this. Harlan or Marcus, what are some of the things that go through the mind of a man when finances are not the way that they should? And then I'm going to come on the ladies that are single as well. What are some of the things that go through the mind of a maid when they're dealing with money issues?
Well, for a man, that's really very hard. And I don't think that ladies understand the depth of how hard that is for a man. And so, you know, when a man, his whole identity, his whole being, his whole self-esteem, his honor, his integrity, all those things that we would call good characteristics of a man, all of those things are under attack. And the enemy is like, you know, whispering in his ear, telling him, you know, how, look at you. You ain't worthy. You ain't good enough. You're not leading, loving, providing, protecting. Look at you, you know. And so the enemy will beat a man down. And that's how men turn to different things outside of the marriage, like drugs or sex or cheating or just simply leave or abuse. That can make if a man is not a real strong man like a man of God, but just the average man, he could turn to violence. He start abusing because that's his way. Like a comedian uses laughter to cover himself and keep people from noticing his faults. A regular man will start abusing verbally, emotionally, physically, or start cheating, or start gambling, start drinking, go off into all manner of things because he's humiliated by the fact that he's not providing well for his family. And so I think that women don't understand when they see their man going through something, they're not understanding the spiritual aspect of it. And they're not understanding that the enemy works to make sure that the man is not capable. And so men are in a fight every day because the enemy knows that if he messes with the family, then he breaks it down. And so just the same trick that he used in the garden, he continues to use it. And so he tries to mess with the man because he knows the man is supposed to leave, love, provide, and protect. And so when the man is not, if he takes away the man's, if he can interrupt the man's income, his job, or whatever, he knows that that man is going to be, men, we have ego, we have pride, all those different things. And I'm not saying that every man is prideful. I'm saying that those things are the things that plague men. Mm-hmm. And so men are very, very concerned about being able to provide, you know, for their family. And when they don't feel like they're doing that well, if they're not, even a man of God is going to be, he's going to be hurt. He's going to be, feel, you know, really bad. It's going to be hard. But if he's not a man of God, then it's going to really go south, really fast. And so what women don't understand is the spiritual aspect, and they blame the man. And so that's why he starts fighting back. And that's why he starts running out or being angry or being very agitated or some start, you know, fighting you or saying really mean things or may start abusing the children or just may start not staying at home. Maybe he's sitting somewhere with some guys drinking or smoking or somewhere where he's not getting what he really needs. And what ladies have to understand is that you can't start blaming like Adam and Eve did. They immediately, well, he did, she did, you know, and it's always the blame. And you have to understand that it's not a physical problem. It's a spiritual problem. Right. And so that man needs to be able to, when ladies see a man, if he's working a job, you need to really understand that you need to pray for one another. You need to pray for each other's jobs. You need to pray for each other. If your man has a business or that he also runs or whatever it is, you need to help him. You need to pray for him, pray with him. You need to help him to get that business up and going. If you're a stay-at-home wife, you need to be helping your husband, and you need to be building your own business. Like, you don't just sit there and say, well, oh, he makes good money. That could change any moment. An app could wipe out his whole company. And so it's very hard for a man when he can't provide for his family. It breaks everything in him, and he needs his woman not to blame him, but to lift him up, not only in prayer, but in words, how you talk to him. You don't treat him anything other than a king. Just because his pockets fell, it doesn't mean he didn't ask that company to lay him off. He didn't ask that job to go away. Help him to get back on his feet. And if you're working, and you don't be running around the house talking about, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm paying this, I'm paying that. That's not the way to go. You do what you have to do to help each other to stand. And you don't blame, your man didn't quit that job. Your man didn't walk away from working. You help him get back where he needs to be.
Amen. That's good, Harlan. And I think a lot of times it boils down to a good communication, having good communication with one another. And that's not just the male or the female, that's both parties, because where one may be, it may be easier for one to articulate the thoughts or what's going on with them. I think this is where it's good to learn that person's love language. You know, how do they express themselves? How do they get messages over? Because sometimes I was counseling this couple a couple of years ago, and I noticed some things within the structure of their marriage. The husband was dealing with a lot of financial issues with him. Not that he wasn't making the money or whatever. I think it was how he was using his money, which was probably some patterns of things that had been picked up or whatever. And one of the ways that he would deflect when the wife would talk about those finances, he would always do something nice for her. You know, he would either go cook a big dinner, or he would, you know, do something, but he wasn't speaking the love language that she needed. You know, she may have come from a background to where she needed safety, and she needed provision. She needed to make sure that things were on task. And for him to speak his love language by doing things for her could be misrepresented, because she's thinking that if you're going to do something for me, you know, don't just go over there and run my bath water, pay these bills, you know. And sometimes we can have big misunderstanding. That's where communication comes in. And also, there's a way to communicate with a person to let them know what your needs are. One, by first always identifying what it is that they have done well, you know, because a lot of times I think that what relationships, whether you're dating or in a marriage or whatever, you have to let people know what they're doing well before you put them on the chopping block about all the stuff that they're doing wrong, and then understand what that person can handle. You know, when you start seeing behaviors, they're not coming home, or they cut you off, whatever the case be, it may be a language that you're speaking that just does not rest well with them. And when we learn how to sit down and communicate more effectively with each other, you could talk about that. I noticed when I started talking about the bills that need to be paid, I noticed that you tend to shy away. Don't run away from it. Don't run away from the conversation. Learn how to have the proper language with the conversation. I think it's so much better. I think marriages can handle more than we think that they can. A lot of times we just run away from it, and we just don't deal with it a lot of times. So, yeah.
And you have to pay attention. Like, when you're talking to people, like, you know, when you're, especially those that are, you know, that are dating, you have to pay attention to those things. You talked about, you know, when you're looking at a person and you're talking to them about things, you know, you got to look at their body language. You have to look at how they respond to things, because if it's something that is, let's say, for example, like you said, if he's not wanting to discuss it when you're asking him about something like that, and he tries to divert or he tries to deflect and things like that, when you get married, it's going to be 10 times worse to you.
Yeah.
It's going to go up 1,000% as far as agitation to you. And so, because a woman feels security hit your mute button. Charwin, when a woman speaks security, you know, you love her, the bills are paid, you spend time with her, you pay attention to her, you talk to her in love, you tell her how much you love her. A woman has to have all of that in order for her mind to be at peace, mm-hmm. because women are facilitators. You were made to meet us with help. And when you don't know what to help us with, it messes you up. It brings anxiety because you have to know you operate in plan mode. Men operate in free mode. Mm-hmm. We can make plans, but we leave more room. We don't. Most men, there are some men that are really meticulous and they plan everything out. But that man is usually a very controlling, or his OCD. If you have that balanced where you know how to plan, but you should be planning together. So here's the problem in marriage. People try to, like, a woman can't have her plans. A man can't have his plans. When you're married, we have to plan. You can't go over here and draw up your own goals. And he can't go over here and draw up his own goals that concern the family. Your personal goals are things that you are self-improving on, your attitude, your character, your spirit, those things that you can do on your own. But things that concern the whole household, we have to do that. So you can't go over here and say, I want this, 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 and this. And then when those things are not checking off on your list, you want to blame your spouse. And then you say, well, I was planning, I thought I would be this or I will be that. Okay, you're not single. And you're married. We had to have me, you, and God. If you went and made the plans by yourself, if I went and made the plans by myself, but it wasn't me, you, and God, there is no plan.
There is no plan.
All we are doing is we're trying to live single, married. We're not single. We are married. The two have become one, and there are three of us. There's me, you, and God. And if me and you don't sit and talk and with God about how we're supposed to direct and run our lives and the things that we're supposed to do, because first of all, we need to align ourselves with the plan of God for our lives. Nobody is doing that. People are thinking that they set their goals and they just take off. You didn't even consult with your father at all. You didn't even consult with your father about any of these things that you're trying to do. You just feel like, well, if I get the house, if I get the job, if I get the promotion, you're thinking all those things are going to set you in a place. But you clearly have to seek first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness. Mm-hmm. And then when you're planning, God is in the plan with you. You plan with him. And that means that you are always aware of what it is that he wants for your life.
That's right.
He does put it in your heart, but he does not want you to try to force anything. He doesn't want you to try to manipulate any situation in your life, your marriage, your spouse, what timing you get, your house or your whatever it is that you're trying to accomplish. He doesn't want you to try to manipulate those things. And I think that the husband and the wife, either one or both, can try to manipulate situations, and they want to overrun each other, and the other one wants the other one to do what I say. And, you know, that's not how it works. If we have to decide what's best for this household, and if one of us loses, we both lose. It has to be what's best for both of us. And the only way that works is if one or both of them are not selfish. You can't be selfish in marriage and expect your plans to work. You can't expect your love, your all those things that you want to happen. They won't happen with selfishness. You have to be selfless like God, and you consider the other person just more than yourself. And in marriage, we don't really call it compromise. We work it out.
Yeah.
Compromise means that I'm lowering something, lowering a standard. Well, in marriage, you're not lowering a standard. You're not supposed to compromise something that is against what's better or what is right. So you it's different if we're trying to plan a trip or something and I say Cali and you say Paris, which one can we afford?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that's not a compromise. It's what is right, what is best at this time. And so that's really what, but men will tend to shut down when it's concerning finances. Women shut down when it's concerning, well, I didn't get what I think I wanted to make me feel secure.
Yeah, I think it is learning the language of one another. There's the book, What Men Are From Mars and Women Are From Venus. Yeah, that's a great book because it really will help you to realize that women think different than men do. And my prayer is that as we're going into 2024, as we're coming into this new year, that we are coming in with understanding. You know, things are not, I heard Harlan saying something at the very beginning of his conversation. You have to start this walk out with God. Anytime that you're trying to work out with your own reasoning, it looked like to me, all those kind of things, we're going to run up against a wall. The Bible says there's a way that seems right to man, but it will end in destruction. And so a lot of times when we find that friction, if you'll just kind of take a note of that, anywhere friction is taking place, there's an absence of God somewhere in the midst of it. And the Bible says, with all you're getting, make sure you get a good understanding. So sometimes, you know, you got to fall back upon a thing. Remember that what he said, confusion is not of God. Anytime we're bringing confusion into relationships, we have to learn how to step back and become selfless in it. And allow God to have the right of way, because to be honest, you don't know what's going on. You don't know what to do, but you have to be honest enough to say, God, I don't know that. I was thinking about something else before we go further with the book. We're getting ready to start up our singles, like Black Love for Singles on next Thursday. And we're also coupling in Naomi's Love with that. One of the things that I would think that would be a great starter with that is talking about the difference between selfishness and selflessness. Because if you're wanting to get into relationship with anybody, whether it be management, on the job, on the church, there has to be a level of selflessness that goes in, learning how to deny yourself. And that does not mean that you don't get anything that you want, but you have to learn how to deny yourself for the greater good or the greater cause of things. And I think that especially for us that have been single for a while, you got to get in practice mode with that. Because when you have been in a place of survival, when you have been in a place where you've been taking care of yourself for a while, you got to tell your psyche we're doing something different. Because if you try to bring people into your life and you have not dealt with that selflessness or selfishness part of, or the other party has not, we're going to run and bump into each other's pain. And when you bump into each other's pain, we say things like, it doesn't work. So I think a lot of times to start things off, you have to talk about these selfless acts that we're having to, you know, take just to yield. And that could be listening, where you may not have been a great listener, learning how to listen, or understanding somebody else's story, understanding what you've learned from this, because this is what this chapter is talking about, owning your faults and your weaknesses, not taking on somebody else's, but to really go in with a better understanding. It says, when Rob was shut down to distance himself, when he was starting to distance himself or shut down from her, says Sharon would notice it and be concerned. It says she'd ask if anything was wrong, and most of the time he would say no. And she'd say she would pray for him. Says over the period of months, they had coexisted in a polite death of marriage. Sharon attributed most of their struggles to the move. The woman is always trying to find out what's wrong, all those kind of things. It says the relocation had taken its toll. But the fact was, long before the move, there were serious seeds of discontentment in their marriage. It says, and Sharon's lack of awareness about these signs of discontent was the most serious part of the issue. Is you see, Sharon had a certain spiritual blindness that she had never allowed God to touch, help, or heal. She was one of those people who had great difficulty taking responsibility for their, she was one of those people who have great difficulty taking responsibility for their life. In Sharon's mind, whenever a problem arose, it was always the fault of someone other than her. Is that she would blame others, excuse others, and not admit to her part of the problem. This is not a rare condition. In fact, we all have it to some degree, and it's been around since the beginning of time. It is when Adam and Eve pointed the finger at each other and the devil blame again. He says, when the Israelites became, let me make sure I'm reading that right. It says, when Adam and Eve pointed the finger at each other and the devil, blame began. He says, when the Israelites became uncomfortable in the wilderness, blame continued. So when Sharon had a severe case of spiritual blindness, she was in good company. She wasn't a bad person. In fact, she was a good person at heart. She loved God, her family, and her friends, and she wanted the best for them all. She worked hard to be a helpful wife, a mother, and friend. And when things went well, they went very well. But when problems arose, things went very bad. Most of the time, the blame went to Rob, since he was the person closest to her. Is for example, when she was overwhelmed with the kids, here it goes. When she was overwhelmed with the kids, okay, it was because Rob worked too much and couldn't help. When they had financial struggles, it was because he didn't make enough money. When she wanted long involved talks with him and he was dead tired, she attributed his resistance to the lack of concern about her feelings. When he disagreed with her opinion and became firm, he was controlling her. And the worst moments came when he mentioned something he did that caused his distress. That's when Sharon would lose it, blow up, and accuse him of being critical and judgmental of her. Is this now, Rob certainly had his share of responsibility also. He would attempt to change to please her, but when he realized that nothing he did was enough, he would simply give up and disconnect. Or he tried to address Sharon's lack of responsibility, but she would just deny it and he would then avoid her. Or he tried to be thick-skinned and strong, not letting her know how much she had hurt him. All in all, he gave up too quickly. How many of you can identify with that part of the story? This is where we're going into owning your faults and your weaknesses. You know, sometimes you've seen the problem. I believe that the Lord does reveal it to women first because we are attention to the detail. Men are not into details. Most times men don't even pick up that. That's why a lot of times you find, y'all, I've been watching a lot of movies. I learn a lot from these movies that I'm watching or the books that I'm reading. And I love watching relationship stories. And there was this story, this gentleman, he had become a senator. And he had just hired this new secretary on him, little young tenderoni, this and that. The girl is young. She don't always know what behaviors are appropriate and what's not appropriate. And most of the time, men miss it anyway. They don't see it. But he and his wife were doing a Zoom call. They do their Zoom calls every morning just to check up on each other because they were in two different states. And in the background, she could see the lady coming in. Of course, the radars are going to go off with a woman anyway when another woman is near her husband, and especially she's a very attractive woman. But it was things that he was just walking over. She was picking his ties for him. She was picking his shirts for him. He would ask questions like, honey, do you like this shirt or that one? Then he would go to the assistant and ask the assistant, do you like that? That would cause some friction in the relationship. But it also has a lot to do with how you handle certain things like that. You know, men normally don't pick up on when a woman is flirting with them or if a woman has gotten too close to them That's how sometimes it's very easy for our relationships to start, you know, but also at the same time, we have to know that as women, that that's just not their strong point. And there are times that you have to learn how to level that out in the relationship and not make that such a big deal. So I want to kind of hit a couple of things before we dismiss this morning. It says Sharon attributed most of their struggle to the move, okay? But it also said that she had a certain spiritual blindness that she had never allowed God to touch, help, or heal. She was one of those people who had great difficulty taking responsibility for her life. Some of the things that you guys heard, you know, when it talked about how she would blame him for certain things when she was overwhelmed with the kids, or it was because Rob was working too much. We always look outside for external things, or when they had financial struggle, it was because he didn't make enough. Then we started worrying them about the monies that are coming in. It says that she wanted long, involved talks with him, and maybe she was doing it at the wrong time. It says that she attributed his resistance to the lack of concern about her feeling. Sounds like a lot of selfishness in the relationship. And the way it sounds, now mind you, this is a matter of perception. They're telling their own, I mean, Henry and John are telling their side of the story and what they recognize. And maybe they did recognize what the gentleman was, you know, struggling with more than anything. Doesn't mean that it's not another side to it. But maybe there were some things that were obvious there. Maybe the way she fussed a lot about things, or maybe the way she approached him with, you know, different things, and not owning up to the fact that when it came time to being overwhelmed with the kids, maybe it was because there was no structure in there. You know, if he's going to be the breadwinner, maybe he is the one out there making the money. You know, you have to, you know, bring some balance in the home. Let's talk about that a little bit. How many of you could see yourself in the story there? And maybe these are things that you guys are going through in your relationship right now, and you're just trying to figure out what in the world is wrong. I'm doing all this. He ain't doing nothing. She ain't doing nothing. And we're just arguing all the time. Anybody have any conversation around that? Or been there or in that right now?
You know, as a divorcee, I think like that now. I try my best not to say what I'm doing versus what my wife is doing and with my kids for financial or being at certain events or taking them places. I try to work together, come up with a solution that can best fit their needs versus our needs. And that's helped me to not put that big I, little you concept in our conversations and keep things more functional. I guess that's a good word to use, functional with us as we talk. And that's allowed us to kind of grow, even not being married and co-parenting. And the kids, who now are our primary purpose of, has always been, but our purpose of being there with each other is to make sure they have the right things they need to become healthy adults. But they can't get that with confusion around. You know, they can't get that with imbalance. They can't get that with conflict all the time. So yeah, I've been working on that piece for at least the last couple of years, for sure. Make sure how my words already come out, that they're not harsh or bitter or too one-sided, stuff like that. So yeah.
And you know what, Mark, I'm glad you brought up that, because even as a counselor, sometimes the counselor can get in the way. You know, because, you know, we see things and deal with things on an everyday basis. Sometimes you have to kind of put that on the back burner when you're dealing with your personal relationships, because, you know, that's an area of expertise that you have that may not be an area of expertise that they have. And like you said, looking out for the best interests of the children. And it does call for a disconnect from the way I see it, and only the way I see it, to help us to come to a common resolve. Where are we trying to go? Okay, who's gonna be able to take the children here? Or, you know, asking the question, if you see your spouse being overwhelmed, that's care, you know, to ask, is there anything that I can do to help out? You know, maybe I need to kind of change my schedule. And then listen, there are oftentimes, even in relationships, you have to make decisions for the betterment of your family, not for the betterment of your job, but for the betterment of your family. There may be some times where that job does not fit your family goals or the vision for your family. And I have seen a lot of people deny the relationship that God has given to them for a selfless act for themselves. And you may say, well, I was out there trying to make money. How is that being selfish? It's being selfish because you're not considering the other person. If this thing is going to bring a strain to your relationship, you being gone all the time, different things like that, that's a conversation piece that has to be had. Because when there is an absence of one person in the household, that puts the pressure of another, on another person. And another thing, say, for instance, if you decide you want to quit your job and whatever the case may be, maybe the job is a little stressful or whatever, that's a conversation that has to be had. We don't just walk away. We pray about those things, because where there's an absence of one thing, somebody else is going to have to pick up the slack to bring things in, you know, just in case if you're not able to do that. So a lot of it is selfless acts. Anybody else want to kind of share on that point this morning? Maybe you've been there. Y'all work through things in your relationship. Y'all stay quiet like y'all do in the room here? I sure hope not. How do y'all work things out? Yes, Miss Kathy?
I just laughed when you said that, because I don't. No, ma'am.
You don't what, Kathy?
I don't stay quiet. No, okay. I don't. Okay.
Okay.
Just tell the truth. Tell the truth. Shame the devil. I was going to say, I can kind of not agree with the lady. What's her name in the book? Is her name Sharon?
Sharon. Uh-huh.
Okay. Where she was saying, like, when we first got married, you know, I wasn't saved. So, you know, I just thought I knew everything. You know, we didn't fuss a lot, because Terry don't fuss a lot, but I did. So, you know, everything didn't go my way. You know, I just fussed a lot, and he just kind of just, you know, let me fuss or whatever. So then, you know, our marriage was shaky or whatever. And then when I got saved, then I really thought I knew everything, you know, and then I thought he should be saved too. So, you know, you're going to try to save him too. You know, I got saved, now he needs to be saved. So then he was fussing, like, you just can't tell me what to do, you know, and that kind of stuff, you know. And I was telling him what the word of God said, and he need to do this and he need to do that. Well, I had to step back, because that wasn't my job to do that, and I can't save him. So I had to learn that the hard way. And now it's more, I'm more at, excuse me, more at peace about it, because now I know I can't save him. He has to make that decision on his own, you know, and God is going to do that. And God has given me word after word, you know, and a confirmation that, you know, that he's going to, you know, change Terry's heart. And I have to stand on what the word of God says, not what Kathy say, and not by, you know, my sight and how I feel and stuff like that. So just kind of walk it out by faith. And, you know, our marriage, you know, we go through stuff, you know, ups and downs, and, you know, we've been married a long time, but I had to get to where I am now. This just didn't happen overnight. And when something is bothering me, you know, I talk to him, and I've heard people say, pick your battles. So that's where I've come to, pick my battles. I don't just, he don't just get home, and I don't just storm in, start talking about stuff, you know, and when I know it's not a good time, because then, you know, I'm just opening a can of worms up for a fight or something like that, you know. I have to pick my battles. I know when to say something to him, and I know when not to say something to him about something, you know, money or, you know, whatever's going on. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I had to figure that out in my own marriage, because everybody is different. So I had to figure that out, you know. So, but I do understand, you know, what she's talking about in the book. So
yeah,
just wanted to share that. Thank you.
You know, thank you so much, Kathy. I heard Kathy say they married so young also. And a lot of time when you're young, you know, you really don't have a lot of tools for relationship. You may have a visual. Maybe your parents were married a long time, and maybe you got a chance to ear hustle on some of the things that they, you know, went through. But mom is not going to share everything with you. Dad's not going to share everything with you. You may get the remnants of things, but you don't learn those things until you yourself get actively involved. And you may have a point of reference that you can look back, oh, that's why they did that, or this and that. It makes me think about relationships needing a vision, you know, needing to get a vision for your relationship. That vision includes family. That vision includes kids. That vision includes finances. That vision includes conflict resolution. That vision includes your faith. That vision includes your business. It includes a lot of things. And what I mean by the vision, whatever the vision is, you have to talk about that at some point or another. What I have seen that people have done, I think it's the maturity of the person. I think that what people have done, you know, when I'm kind of observing, looking even from my own marriage, sometimes we get into things and we think that, oh, well, we'll get the roadmap as we go along. I do believe that you will. All right. Have a great one, Marcus. I believe that you will get twos as you go along, but there need to be some preparedness too. There need to be some preparedness for what you're walking into on anything, because the more tools you have, the more successful you'll be. You're going to pick up some tools as you're going along, but I think you need to have some tools on the way, whether it be even learning about one another, you know, sitting down, you know, how does your spouse or how do you deal with things when things get rough? You know, what's your temperament? You know, do you throw in the towel? Do you give in? You know, have you been dealing with rejection for a long time? Do you bring that into your relationship? I think that vision has to be before you enter into the life of other people. And then God will add to your faith as you go along. You'll learn more things. And then sometimes you'll even unfold in the areas of that. I may have that on my vision board, but remember, I'm trying to get clear on what it is that I see. I know these are things that show up in relationships that cause relationships to fail. So I don't want to talk about the failure part. I want to put it on my vision board. How do we make this better? How do we walk into this relationship with clarity? You know, how do we learn from things that we have watched other people go through? Owning my faults. All right, I'm listening to the story this morning and I'm recognizing I may not say anything in the room, but that's me too. You know, that's how I've dealt with things. And I think the key is, first point, when you recognize that that may be part of the issue, that's the first door of opening for God to come in, for him to help us do things. And then we have to sit down at the table and learn of God to figure out, all right, God, what are the tools that we need to add? You may think because you've been married for a long time that your marriage is foolproof, fireproof. It is not. Some people just going through. Some people are just there. And you don't want to ever take it for granted that your marriage is going to survive through things like that, or your relationship on your job is going to survive through that. You have to put work in and you have to bring other people to it. Anybody want to have anything else to say on this? And I think we'll kind of close out until we come back tomorrow. It's so much in this chapter, y'all, that we're going to bring out. Does anybody have anything else that they'd like to share this morning, or somewhere you found yourself in sharing to where you were not taking your own responsibility for your own life? You were busy taking responsibility for them. It's easy to talk about somebody else's wrong and what they're doing, but it's hard for us to admit when it's us that's doing it. How many are taking responsibility? Okay. All right. Y'all, let's come in tomorrow. Let's be ready for conversation as we go forward, because I know you guys are going through some things and you don't want to expect everybody else to work it out for you, or you hear other people's stories. Get involved in it, you know, so that you know, God, I want to be, I want to get some answers to these things myself. And I want to be able to open up if it's me that's doing things. I want to be able to pull the covers back on it, because you definitely don't want repeats of things that's taking place in your life. I want to close on this. It said that Sharon wasn't a bad person. In fact, she was good at heart. You already know that. But at the same time, when the problems arose and things went bad, most of the time, where do we put that blame at? That's what we want to start thinking about. Am I shifting the blame? I'm asking God to make a way in this relationship, in my marriage, but am I taking responsibility for my part? Well, I didn't do anything wrong. A curse without a cause does not come. God said he's not the author of confusion with things. And we have to be open and honest about the things that are going on. So let's get ready tomorrow. I'm going to bring just a battery of questions and conversation pieces for us to talk about as we're going through this. And I want us to open up tomorrow and let's talk about, you know, where things are. Not the struggle of the other people, but the struggle within yourself. We want to stop shifting blame on other people. We want to own up to the things that are going on with us. And let's find language for that. Maybe we got an easy language for what everybody else is doing wrong, but have you stopped to take the time out to learn the lessons that you need to learn through whatever it is that you're going through? Maybe write down some areas of struggle that you're going through in your relationships. You know, maybe it's I can't get them to talk, or, you know, I'm struggling understanding this. Well, this is what my mom and daddy did, you know, all those kind of things. Write those things down so that we can come back in and talk about it on tomorrow, so that we can, you know, get to the bottom of these things. Anybody else have anything else before we dismiss this morning? Okay. All right. Well, let's get ready to close out. I want to thank y'all for just this, just a, remember that first day is just kind of getting that door pried open. And then the next couple of days we walk through it and we literally admit to the Lord, God, I know that my ways are not your ways. And my thoughts are not your thoughts. But God, I really need your help through this. You know, I'm secretly going through something that's going to become public in a little while. And God, I need your help. Even if it's me getting an understanding about how you operate, you know, maybe that's where I got to start. I got to start back with you. Maybe I got to pull back, you know, me being so prideful or me having all the answers to things. Or maybe I'm more spiritual than they are. Or maybe, you know, I'm always the one taking care of this and that. I'm going to take back the I ams. I am doing all this. Unless you're affirming yourself that, you know, I am capable. You know, I am able. But don't want to put the I ams in a fault-finding way. You know, we're going to start owning up to our own responsibilities with things. I think that's how we get stronger. So. Well, Father, we thank you this morning. Y'all, I want y'all talking now. I want us to come in new this year. Father, we thank you so much for just opening this door. So much can be said within this just one couple of pages, because this is where a lot of people are. They're stuck in their relationships. Father, there is a secular way to handle battles. And then there's a spiritual way to go about doing things. We are covenant keepers. We believe the word of God is the final authority. And whatever we do, whether it be in word or in deed, we do this unto you. Lord, we lift up our relationships before you. We lift up our understanding before you. We lift up our hearts and our possessions before you. And Father, we say that it all belongs to you anyway. Give us back the portion that we need. We're giving that 10% to you as an offering. We're lifting ourselves up as a living sacrifice today, holy and acceptable unto God. You know, and we ask, Lord God, that you give us the answers. Help us to see us. But a lot of time we're looking out the window at everybody else and we don't see the us in it. So Father, I pray that you would make straight ways our feet, help our feet to be like hind feet, Lord God, that we can stand tall. Even when it comes to dealing with adversity, because we know that it's the humility that comes in that helps lives become changed. Father, teach us what to say, when to say, how to say it. so that, Father, we can bring about a better resolution to the end of the struggles that we may be going through. You said faith without works is dead, being alone. Father, those that are more spiritual and more mature, much is required of them. Sometimes we're the ones that have to hold our tongue. Sometimes we're the ones that have to pray for understanding for others. But let us not be proud and boastful and brag about what it is that we can do so much better than others. Because though we may have all the knowledge in the world, the Bible says it's like a tinkling, you know, it's like nothing if you don't have love. So, Father, I pray that you would help us to have understanding as we walk through 2024, because that's how we're going to win these battles in life. We understand if it had not been for the Lord that was on our side, we don't know where we would be. So, Father, humble us, humble our hearts, humble our thoughts, take us from a place of selfishness to a place of selflessness. So, Father, when we do what you do, we can have what you have. And, Father, we need peace in our homes. We need peace in our minds. We need restoration. There will be no restoration without God's hand upon it. So, Father, we thank you. As we come back tomorrow, I'm putting this in the atmosphere in advance. Lord, open up your people. Help us to come in ready to share and ready to talk, because we're all overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the words of our own testimonies. And we thank you in advance for what you're doing. Bless us throughout this day, Lord God. Let it be a day of sweatless victory. Everything that we stand in need of, healing, health, resources, finances, peace, Lord God, whatever it is we stand in need of, Father, we ask you to provide, and we thank you in advance for it, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys so much. Y'all, the recordings will come out in the evenings now. So if you guys would just wait, it'll probably be around 7 or 8 o'clock at nighttime. I'm having to shift my schedule a lot. So y'all, if you want to go back and listen to the replay, I'm trying to make sure that it goes out to where before y'all go to bed at nighttime, you can go back and recap on it and be ready for conversation on tomorrow. You guys be blessed. Invite somebody in to join us. This is a wonderful study that I believe will bring about great changes with us all. You guys be blessed on this Wednesday. In Jesus' name, amen.